Welcome to another episode of Inside the Line, Real Stories by Real Cops. You can catch us on insidetheline.org. You can catch us, you can email us at realstoriesbyrealcops@gmail.com. And please share, because we want to share. Well, I wouldn't say we want to share the love, Dale. I'd say we want to share.
There's a lot of love. This might not be a lot of love being shared today in this podcast, but we usually share a lot of love.
We'll see what the audience thinks in terms of how much love we've got to share. That's Dale Lawrence, retired police officer. I'm Dave Rattigan, comedian, professor, former journalist. And with us, as we frequently have him, comedian, actor, heavy sleeper, Nathan Arroyo.
You know what that means? You know what that means when Nathan comes aboard? It means shenanigans are going to happen.
Is it
something unpredictable will happen?
I might have meant that we were recording late enough in the day. Nathan, how was your New Year's Eve? It was good?
I fell asleep at 10 o'clock, and then I woke up a year later.
Wow. A regular Rip Van Winkle. All right. Good. No. So you didn't get into any trouble?
I mean, my liver did, but the rest of me is fine.
I forget that. I forget that the way that fell asleep is a euphemism for passed out
drunk. There you go.
Anyway, this week we're going to call this Policing in America, One Step Forward, 10 Steps Back.
We might call it Two Steps Forward, 10 Steps Back. I'm trying to figure that out right now.
Is that what we talked about?
Yeah, we talked about that about a minute ago.
Yeah, I wasn't listening.
So it's either One Step Forward, 10 Steps Back, or Two Steps Forward, 10 Steps Back. Big decision.
Nathan, what do you think?
It's about 5 steps back, half a step forward, but it's off a cliff.
Ooh, that's good. So basically, Dale, what you're doing is you're saying, let's go with the Springsteen song. And Nathan is saying, let's go with the Watusi along with a Warner Brothers cartoon. Anyway, you've got a disclaimer?
We're big supporters. 110% we support law enforcement. We support cops on the street.
I just want to say this. It's 100%.
It's 110%.
I know there's no such thing as 110%. I was a sports writer. There was no such thing as 110%.
It sounds good.
It's 100%.
But anyway.
All right, fine.
So we support them 100%, Dave, to be correct. So we try to be objective here, because if we're objective, then we're going to have a lot more credibility in the podcast. So when we see something happening in law enforcement, like we observed in the last couple of weeks with the NYPD, which we're going to get into, then we're going to call them on it, because to have any validity, you got to be able to be objective and look at it from both sides of the fence. But before we do that.
Yep. And one thing you do is you look at everything objectively, and you're not afraid to criticize the people who make the decisions at the top of the food chain.
Absolutely. I love doing that.
like many police officers, you have no problem criticizing the brass and the politicians.
Absolutely.
Okay.
All right.
We got to get that in there. Okay.
So we're going to kind of start off with a somber note. It was New Year's Eve in Cleveland, Ohio, and there was a carjacking. A lot of the particulars haven't really been released, but there was a off-duty officer from Cleveland Police Department, Officer Shane Bartek. He was confronted by two thugs, a male and a female. The female, I believe, had the weapon. There was some sort of an altercation, and the female shot the off-duty officer 2 times, killing him. Cleveland Police Department, I was there about a year ago for a retirement party for a good friend of mine from the Marine Corps, Bo Diaz, who did 32 years, Cleveland PD. He was a sergeant. So I went out to Cleveland. Met a whole bunch of Cleveland cops, great guys, great ladies. Cleveland's a very tough town. These are very seasoned, hardcore police officers that work in there. But you know something? They're very loyal to each other. So this type of a situation where one of their young officers was murdered, I'm sure they're bonding and trying to make some sense of it.
How do you make sense of a murder of a 25-year-old?
Yeah, there's it's senseless, but it definitely brings the department together and it hardens their resolve to get these criminals off the street.
Here's what I always think whenever I read a story like this, and again, there might be other factors, but if you've got a 28-year-old and you've got an 18-year-old and they're together and they murder somebody in a situation like this, now maybe, who knows, maybe that was like one of those things of if I point the gun at him, he's going to do what I want. and then maybe he didn't do, who knows? There's a lot of speculation here.
Yeah, a lot of it hasn't been released yet, but I think from a cop's perspective, they're just too thugs, they're punks.
So my question is, as an officer, do you feel that there are people that we should just, as a society, throw away?
Throw away the key, absolutely.
Throw away the key, or just throw them away and the death penalty?
I mean, the death penalty is kind of a political type issue. A death penalty doesn't intimidate criminals from going out there on the street, so it's not a deterrent.
You know what I've been told is it's actually more expensive to put somebody to death because of the appeals process and everything else that it is to just hold them for life. I don't know. This brings it up again and again and again. You see people who are career criminals who are just
constantly on the street, constantly getting bailed out, constantly put on probation or the monitoring system, GPS monitor. Right. It's useless.
Crimes of violence or crimes of
sexual assault type crimes.
Yeah. Well, why don't we just get rid of them?
Trust me, you can probably poll every member of the Cleveland Police Department right now, and they'll tell you that's the same thing they think they should do with them. Let's go to a more positive note, because a lot of law enforcement nowadays, they only accentuate the negative and not the positive. When was it? Monday, December 27th in Colorado, a active shooter was on the loose. Individual killed 5 people until he ran into a...
Ashley Ferris?
Yeah, Ashley Ferris. Ashley Ferris was her name, or is her name, and she's the police officer who confronted the active shooter. She was shot by him, but as she was on the ground, she was able to take him out and save countless other potential innocent victims from an active shooter. And you didn't see a lot of press on this. Nothing much was said about it.
Why do you think not?
Because it's not doom and gloom. You got to accentuate what police officers do. We're trying to build up the confidence and the trust in police officers.
And all
they do is put out the negative things that they do.
Here's my argument. And I see this a lot in social media where somebody says, blah, 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 this happened, this was good, or a police officer was killed and you don't see it in the mainstream media. We're not going to see this in the media. Well, unfortunately, these are things that shouldn't be news. The idea that a cop foils a robbery and kills the active shooter. Actually, that was actually a pretty significant story. I'm sure it got a lot of play.
Didn't get that much, but go ahead.
Really?
Not that much.
No, that has got to be a reason. But national play, the reason, again, the reason a lot of these things don't get national play is cops get shot during the line of duty, and cops foil crimes in the line of duty. It happens, and it's the way it should be, and it shouldn't be news. It's unfortunate. It's tragic. It's locally, yes, it should be news. Beyond the local area, when it gets to the point where the killing of a cop is a national story, unfortunately, it'll basically mean that nobody's killing cops, and it becomes really unusual for somebody to do that. And so far, it hasn't. So it makes it not news. And the other thing, of course, is that there's not video of it. Had there been video of it, and there probably was. I mean, it probably was inside.
I'm sure there's some video somewhere. It hasn't been released yet.
Maybe that hasn't been released, but there wasn't somebody with a cell phone recording who puts it on social media where it amplifies, and then because it amplifies, it becomes news. That's kind of a new phenomenon that we've had over the past 20 years that we probably didn't have before, where something amplifies.
Yeah, absolutely.
I put it on, let's say Nathan goes somewhere and some cop sees him and they've seen him at a comedy club, so the cop decides to start beating him with his nightstick, and one of his friends says, this is horrible. Let me video. So he takes out his phone, and there's Nathan getting beaten up by the cop.
He made a anti-cop joke.
Maybe, or maybe it just, general taste. Maybe the cop just didn't like his act and go, we don't really like
those voices. Well, I've heard his act. He's got a good act.
You ever been beaten by anybody because of your comments on stage, Nathan?
I mean, I'm waiting.
Anyway, so I think it's great that it happened. It's great that she's okay. It's great that she saved lives. I'm surprised there's not more coverage on this, to be honest. Go ahead. What's the next one?
Oh, yeah. I got a couple of shout-outs.
Oh.
First shout-out, our old friend Frankie Bravo.
Hopefully
he's doing well.
He is. He is.
He is doing well.
I'm told he's, I guess he's getting kind of grouchy.
Oh, there you go.
Which means he's back to normal.
Very good. And I'm going to give another big shout out to a good friend of mine. He's an avid listener. He's from the Fall River, Massachusetts area. He's a former professional fighter. He was on the 1984 Olympic trials bronze medalist, almost made it to the Olympic team, by the name of David the Choir Boy Govan. 17-1, baby. He was a great fighter. Great fighter.
Really?
Absolutely. His brother is the new chief of police in Fall River, Paul Govan. So hopefully wish him some luck down there. Fall River's a tough town, baby.
Yeah, it is a tough town. But you said that he was 17-1?
17-1.
Why'd he stop fighting?
Well, you know, I didn't hear this from him, but just the scuttlebutt inside the boxing business.
Oh, the scuttlebutt.
The scuttlebutt inside the boxing world is that he was a 120-pound fighter. And the 120-pound weight class is pretty much dominated by Mexican fighters.
Yeah.
So he was kicking all their asses. So I think the Mexican drug cartel said to him, hey, Govan, you ain't going to beat our Mexicans anymore. So we're going to threaten you with your life. So you either quit boxing or you're going to lose to the Mexican drug cartels. So I think he retired because of that. That's a joke. He didn't retire because of that. Probably an injury. Most boxers retire usually because of an injury.
So wait a minute.
What?
It was a great story.
Yeah.
Right up until you reveal that it was false. It was a great story. And I don't know if I should call him out. What do you think, Nathan? Call him out for using racial stereotype tropes, or let it go because...
Just let it go.
Or just be mad at him for revealing that it was... not the real story behind the story.
I mean, this just sounds like an episode of Breaking Bad, honestly.
It does. Great show.
You will take a dive in the fifth round.
You know, the most realistic part of Breaking Bad, I thought, was where the guy, when he's trying to escape, he goes into New Hampshire, just living by himself in a crappy little place out in the woods. And everyone I meet from New Hampshire, they're either from southern New Hampshire, which means that they have a beard, but it's very neatly trimmed. They have a truck to go to their job as a computer person, or they're hermits out in the woods hiding from cartels or law enforcement. Anyway, let's get to main focus of the show. Just when you think the law enforcement profession in America is beginning to rebound in terms of favorability with the public, we have a new confidence trust survey. Police favorability ratings since 2011. It has been in the mid to low 50% amongst whites and in the mid to low 20% amongst minorities. And in the late to mid 2021, the confidence trust has risen slightly among whites, close to 60, but has dipped below 20% among minorities, which means, Dale, well, you're the stat guy.
Just as I expected, I went out there and I started looking at favorability surveys about law enforcement. There's so many out there, and the numbers are, you know, they're not so vastly different, but I kind of had to look at them a little bit and try to come to a mid-level of them. And what I found was, yeah, in the minority community, they really still don't trust cops, and there's not a lot of confidence in law enforcement in those communities. And I can see that. There's a lot of stuff out there on social media where cops may or may not be heavy-handed in those communities, and I think we have a lot of work to do there. I guess in the white, Caucasian, middle-class community, we were starting to come back. And then as we're starting to come back, a couple of things popped up in New York City in the last couple of weeks. One of the largest police departments in the country, and what they do and what is put out on social media with how they handle situations, and we're going to talk about a couple of situations in which the New York Police Department... they had their community impact teams out at a Burger King and an Applebee's.
Hold on. We'll get to that in a second. What was this you've got here for index crimes as of October 2021?
So the index crimes are murder, rape, robbery, assault, and larceny. So if you just go from 2020 to 2021, now the only good thing I can say about that is in New York, as of October this year, there's 8 less murders. There's 399 murders. So there's 8 less than there were last year.
We're doing great.
Yeah, we're doing great. But let's not get too happy about that. Not too confident, Dave, because rapes are up 25. They're around 1,241. Wow. Robberies are up 174. They're close to 11,000 robberies. Assaults are up 1,400. 18,000, close to 19,000. And larcenies are up another 11,000.